Blockbuster movies. Well, let me give you a little bit of background about these two gentlemen and their work in Hollywood. Jack Epps Jr. is a professional screenwriter and professor and chair of the Writing and Screen and Television Division at the University of Southern California School of Cinematic Arts. Epps is best known for co-authoring the screenplays for Top Gun, Dick Tracy, and The Secret of My Success. In addition, he's recently had his first book published, Screenwriting is Rewriting, which is a text that we actually use here in the School of Cinematic Arts. Stephen D'Souza is one of a handful of screenwriters whose films have earned over $2 billion, that's with a B, at the box office.
That's worldwide, let's not get too carried away. It's only a billion here.
Movie credits include 48 Hours, Commando, Die Hard, The Running Man, Judge Dredd. In addition, he's been nominated two times, each for the Edgar Allan Poe Award for Best Mystery Screenplay and the Saturn Award for the Best Science Fiction and Fantasy Film. So I think that's deserving another round of applause for these gentlemen. A real treat for you all to listen to the wisdom and insight that I'm sure will be coming forth today. So we are going to be talking about blockbuster movies and their importance for the Hollywood studios and how they've evolved over time. And have special consideration for writing, for the writers among you, thinking about, well, I want to write a blockbuster. But before we do that, I'd like to kind of provide a context or get some background on you each individually. First, I'd like to ask, do you remember when you first, it came into your consciousness that there were actually people who wrote movies? Like it wasn't just the actors acting? Can you go way back and say, yeah, there's actually like a gig that people do? Do you have any memories on that, Jack?
Well, for me, I started making movies when I was in college, and I think that's when, you know, the first script I wrote was in the back of an envelope. You know, it was like, okay, go here, shoot, you know, because I started making them as opposed to writing them. And so I never really thought about it, you know.
Yeah.
At that time, I thought the actors said all the words. You know, you just didn't know it.
Right.
And until I came out to Los Angeles and started pursuing my career, did I start really learning how to write and what that all meant.
Yeah, so often they'll say, oh, the screenwriter writes the dialogue,
right?
You hear that a lot. How about you, Stephen? Do you have any
Well, like Jack, I was one part of that first generation of kids running around with 8mm camera in high school. I made a 20-minute film called Goldfinger. I think you can surmise the plot. It was my parody of Goldfinger, and I even had, the best singer in the school chorus is saying, cold finger, and he stole ice, of course. But anyway, I won a Kodak Cine Award, which is a national prize, and that sort of convinced me, hey, maybe this is actually a career. But I sort of didn't really focus on screenwriting. I just made that film. There was no like real script, you know what I mean? And there was no sync dialogue either. It was sort of like Don Juan, an early talkie. I had sync sound that I sort of, and a few lines of dialogue. But I was always trying to write. I was a cartoonist. You should see my storyboards. They're better than Martin Scorsese's. but my movies may not be, but my storyboards are. And in fact, I was first published in high school in a national magazine, a men's magazine. I brought it to school, and I got in trouble immediately because it was a fold-out, you know. And I said, no, I didn't bring it for the fold. Oh, they all say that. And for the next several years in college, I was still writing for magazines, and I had the dumb luck. I had to, my number came up in the draft, so I was away in the Army for a while. When I came back, I said I'm going to try to get a job in the entertainment business. Maybe I could be like an assistant to somebody at a local TV station. So I went in to really basically be a gopher or a floor director, any kind of like entry level job. And by dumb luck, the 2 days before I had this interview, I had an article I wrote in the Sunday New York Times on the front page, got $250, but everybody on the East Coast in the entertainment business saw this. So I go into this TV station to get a job, but I'm thinking, you know, with a very thin resume, some kind of assistant, and they go, oh, would you like to be a writer producer here? It was a PBS day. I go, oh, okay, sure. When I came to Hollywood, which is another story, because I had worked at that one time, and when I finally got hired at Universal Studios, because of a quirk that had been a union shop, I had to be hired as a producer. So they tried to hire me at the bottom as a staff writer, but they had to make me a story editor because I had that one thing like 3 years earlier. So, you know, I didn't really, you know, think about the script writing until I said, I'm going to Hollywood. I guess I should take scripts because these articles and magazines aren't scripts. And I actually had to go to the only bookstore in the East Coast, Cinemabilia in New York, to get some books to know what a screenplay script looked like. You know, I knew it wasn't a play script. So it was kind of an evolution. And if you had woke me up in the middle of the night when I was in high school, I said, I'll be a writer, but I don't think I would have, or a comic book writer, you know, which I only started doing 5 years ago, the comic books.
Now, Jack, you were at Michigan State.
Yes.
Right. And so were you studying script writing there or just making movies with, off the back of the envelope? Kind of thing?
Well, I went to Michigan State as pre-med. And a biochem class told me I was not going to be a doctor. And so it was, you know, 8 a.m., headwind. No, not a good idea. And I started, you know, I wrote a story in a class. It was a GE class. And it was write like a writer you admired. And there was a Hemingway story. And it's a long story. But let's say it involved a hangover, which helped me write better. It really did. And I realized, I said, well, I could go to school and write and read books. So I became an English major and then studied creative writing.
Creative writing.
So I started, and at that time there was screenplays. You couldn't find screenplays at that time.
No,
they didn't exist. So it wasn't like you could read one. So wrote plays. So I studied playwriting and trying to, you know, some of that as a creative writer. But really didn't think about screenwriting until after I made a movie.
Do you all realize how lucky you are at being able to see all these PDFs that you can download now? I mean, back in the day, it was like a drug dealer. You'd be on street corners hanging out. I got a copy of Top Gun.
Yeah, right, we trade off. We trade, and people would trade. Well, I got this. What do you have? And then you'd make a copy, give it back. And I still have that script library I built up.
Wow.
And to get one. Well, my wife was working at Paramount at the time, and she was working at Paramount in the business end. So I'd get a copy of the script, throw it into a cabinet. So she'd take it out of the cabinet and bring it home. So it was, you know, reading The Godfather and reading Day of the Locust and hearing these amazing Paramount movies. And
just, wow.
The script became something that was very special, and you started to understand
now,
it.
Now, both of you had early on success in TV, right? I mean, let's see, as I recall, Jack, you had Hawaii Five-O and Kojak as some credits. Steven, I think Knight Rider was in there. Could you maybe talk a bit about how you wound your way into the TV thing before you got into the film thing? Maybe Steven first.
All right. Well, I had, like I said, I had stumbled into a nice job at a local PBS station in the Philadelphia area. It was actually across the river in Trenton, New Jersey. But then after a while, they had some layoffs, and I was out of work. And I said, all right, I've got to give myself, I'm going to hate myself if I never try actual show business. I'm going to go to Hollywood. So I knew that even though I had numerous appearances in print, probably if you added up my entire print career of 20 appearances in national magazines, and maybe it added up to $6,000 made over 4 or 5 years. But I knew I had to write scripts, so I got samples of scripts because the only things I could find in print, it wasn't the real format. You'd get a book, Great American Screenplays, but it was printed up in really not the real format, like a plate to fit the book. So I sat down and I spent, it took me 5 years to graduate high school because I always had either Isaac Asimov or Raymond Chandler behind my algebra book. So I sat down and I wrote a science fiction script, a science fiction horror script, and I wrote a crime script. And I said they shouldn't be longer than 120 pages long. And I came out to LA and I, you know, said goodbye to my wife and my little 3-year-old daughter. And I said, I'm going out to Hollywood to give myself 3 months to be successful. That seems reasonable, 3 months. And unfortunately, I had an aunt and uncle to stay with. So I arrive on a Saturday, and Sunday, I look in the newspaper, maybe I should get a job I might have to work for a real job for a couple of months before I work in Hollywood. So I'm looking in the newspaper and I see an ad that says, wanted contestants for a game show. So I figured, I'll go down there. So I went to this game show audition on Monday. It was a show called Crosswits. And 400 people show up. They give you a crossword puzzle to do that was really simple to eliminate people who are really dim-witted. Then the survivors, they had you get up in front of them, and you can see I'm not shy, to make sure you wouldn't freeze in front of a crowd. And they say, okay, you guys will come back and play the game show for pretend, and then we'll be on the show. All right, so then Tuesday, I went to my only contact in Hollywood, which is my aunt's best friend, who was Merv Griffin's secretary. Merv Griffin had a talk show. So I go see her at CBS, and I remember to this day, I walk in CBS Studios, and I saw the Hollywood Squares people, in the flesh. There's the center square, And she breaks my heart and says, well, we really don't hire your kind of writers here. They have game show, question writers. But Merv had a young lawyer who I think became an agent. I can put you in touch with him. Okay, so that's good. So then the next day, I go to the game show for the actual for real recording. And I win a car and a color TV and a stereo. A car you need in LA. Okay. I drop off the stuff at the guy who's literally loading his desk up out of a carton. he calls me the next day at like 1 o'clock in the morning at my aunt's and says, I love your stuff. I think it's great. I took the liberty of giving it to another client of mine. And I said, gee, I'd love feedback from an actual writer. He says, no, you don't understand. We have clients at this agency who are directors, producers, and he's a producer of The $6 Million Man, and they're having a real hard time getting writers for that show because a combination science fiction, police procedural. So people who are coming off of, say, Hawaii 5-0 will come in and say, okay, he flies to the top of the roof and catches the bad guy, and we say he can't fly. And they say, why not? And they don't understand we have like a very limited palette of what he can do. And the people coming from Star Trek come in and say he uses his eye to look through the safe and sees the secret documents, and they know he has to get a warrant, and it's a secret. So because you did a science fiction script and we think you're a good fit, so go interview him. So I went the next day, this is now Friday, came on Saturday, go to Friday, I meet Harv Bennett, who later on did the Star Trek movies. And he says, well, what are your ideas? And I had the good sense to talk about how problematic being the $6 million man would be. Like, you chase a villain through the airport, but the metal detectors go off and they stop you. Or you get in the elevator and it says the maximum weight, but he weighs like 800 pounds. And they go, wait a minute, you know. So Harv Bennett said, this is what we want. People understand how to get these, you know, super-powered heroes into a pickle. Go see Betty about parking. And I said, well, my aunt dropped me off. I don't need to get validated. And they said, no. For your parking space, you start here Monday.
Wow.
So that was it. But again, you know, it's like timing, luck, and preparation. And I think this was a combination of them. So I started the following Monday and they wanted to hire me a staff writer, but they had to make me a story editor because I'd worked at a union shop in Trenton, New Jersey. And I was on the Bionic show. So I did the Bionic Woman and $6 Million Man. I did the Hardy Boys. And I worked my way up the food chain at Universal till I was a producer of Knight Rider.
Wow.
And then Paramount stole me over and said, if you come here, we'll get you in the feature business, which happened after a few more pilots.
So the takeaway here is when you move to L.A., go do a game show.
Yeah.
Or have an aunt and uncle you can crash with. Yeah.
Jack, how about you? How'd you go from Michigan State to getting into the TV thing?
Well, it wasn't quite as dramatic as that. It was somebody who I'd met at State, was in California originally. I looked him up when I moved out here. It's sort of like somebody you knew. He said, well, my dad knows Phil Leacock, the executive producer of Hawaii 5-0. If we write a treatment, he can get it to the producer. So we said, great. Well, you asked me if I want to do it with him. I said, yeah, let's do it. So we sat down. We thought of every cliche we could think of for Hawaii 5-0, just one after another, and just had fun, put it together. Sort of a lark, didn't think anything would come of it. Sent it to him. He sent it to the producer. Got a phone call the next day. You know our show. This is great. You know, and that was the first lesson in Hollywood. Oh, they like cliche out here. So all that stuff in my English paper said cliche. You know, it was actually a good thing I learned. It was something positive. And, so we did a little TV with a different partner, did a little TV, and not as extensive as Steve's, but I think what was beneficial was we pitched a lot. Mm. And it gave me, because once you've written something and you've got a stamp that you've gotten something produced, we did a lot of pitching together, which allowed me, especially in a room, to just learn how to break stories. Mm. I think that's a really hard skill. One of the hardest skills as a writer is how you get an idea, it's a great idea, but how do you turn that into a story, and how do you distill it down into a pitch and do it quickly?
That was a great skill. I would agree with that, and being on the staff of a show, you're in all these pitches, multiple pitches all week, and you quickly sort of learn, you know, how to cut to the chase, what works, and learn how to solve problems.
Mm. Yeah, problem solved. Now, was this partner, was this Jim Cash?
No, it wasn't Jim Cash. It was Anderson House before I worked with Jim.
Well, so let's talk a little bit about that, sure. Cash and Epps. It was for people who were working in the business back in the 80s and 90s, I mean, that was a very,
unique.
Yeah. So to explain the situation, because you were in Santa Monica or wherever, and Jim was back in East Lansing.
Jim was my screenwriting professor at Michigan State. And when he heard they'd sold something, he called me and said, we should try to write together. And I thought, I always liked his work. He was a novelist, and I'd read his stuff, and I was more the filmmaker at Michigan State, and he had seen my movies, and we had talked a lot, and we're good friends, and so we said, okay, let's try something long distance, because the other partnership sort of petered out, and so Jim stayed in East Lansing, I stayed in California, Santa Monica, and we basically worked on our first feature together. We did a spec script together. Meanwhile, he was working at the PBS station, and I was basically doing a lot of just camera work, assistant camera work, just things like that while I was working on our writing. And we spent about 2 years on our first spec script, because it just had to be right. I knew that from
most of that was the mail going back and forth. I think
it was the mail. Although we did have the first fax machine, that was something special. But
which you won on a game show.
I actually did go on a game show. It was a compatibility game show. It was a Dick Clark show. I was so incompatible. It was terrible. I mean, it really was. I'm lucky I have my wife who loves me because, all right. I'll pay for that. So it was an interesting relationship because it was a long distance. We didn't work in the same room together. We never worked in the same room together. And actually that was great because it allowed us to have two creative voices, two creative perspectives, and not be in each other's face all the time. We'd have a problem, we'd say, I'll call you in a half hour, we'd hang up the phone, we'd think about it, come back together, pick up the phone, and we both almost always have the same answer. But it was part of that instinct that we had together.
And I think, if I read correctly, you wrote seven scripts and one of them was Top Gun.
Well, we had seven unproduced screenplays. So we were getting hired, our first script was very well received, and we wrote another spec script, and that went off on an auction, and that was a nice thing to have. And then we started getting assignments, like most writers do. You write something that impresses people in the town, and they start hiring you to write their ideas. Mm-hmm. Because one of the truths in Hollywood is that you have the studio's idea, and you have your idea. Now, when the studio has to make a decision, which one do you think they like better? They tend to like their idea. So if you really want to get something produced, work on their idea. Mm-hmm. But you have to have your idea first. That shows that you're writing this really good spec and you know how to write their idea to get you positioned properly.
So was Top Gun an assignment?
Top Gun was an assignment, yes it was.
Okay, yeah. Well let's use that as a segue into this the topic of the conversation today, Blockbuster. It got me thinking, what's the origin of the word Blockbuster? Does anybody know where the word Blockbuster came from? Have any thoughts on that?
Are we allowed to raise our
hand? Yeah, sure.
Game show guy, he's got to know it. Okay, here he is.
Well, I believe it was it's for a certain kind of bomb in World War
right.
II, you
exactly.
know, from the Blitz.
Okay.
But right. but I also think in Hollywood it segued that like a blockbuster was a movie that was failed originally and somehow it segued into a hit.
And then the bomb became the word for the fail.
Yeah,
yeah, I actually did some research on that, and you're absolutely right. It was these big bombs that the Brits came up with, these 6-foot-long, 2-ton bombs that would bust a block. And so then that made its way to Hollywood, Blockbuster. In fact, I even found an article in Film Bulletin in 1954 where Max Youngstein, who was a vice president at United Artists after they bought it from the original founders of the company, he described Blockbusters as, quote, movies that would do at least $2 million in business in the U.S. and Canada. So that's evolved quite a bit. Well, now, you've all both had your share of writing blockbuster movies. Let's start with Top Gun. Jack, I did a little adjusted gross dollars for each of the movies we're going to talk about today. 1986 Top Gun was the biggest grossing movie of the year, if I'm not mistaken. Grossed $356 million worldwide. Anybody want to take a guess what that would be in adjusted gross dollars today? $784 million, which would have been a big hit today as well as it was back then. So anyone who hasn't seen the movie, IMDb logline, as students at the United States Navy Elite Fighter Weapons School compete to be the best in class, one daring young pilot learns a few things from a civilian instructor that are not taught in the classroom. Starring Tom Cruise, Val Kilmer, and Kelly McGillis, directed by Tony Scott. So what was your background and involvement with the movie Top Gun?
I was working at the time on Dick Tracy for Universal and Paramount, and I was going through a lot of drafts and working. I got to know Jeffrey Katzenberg pretty well, and so Jeffrey approached me and Jim with, it was one of those breakfast meetings, the famous Katzenberg breakfast meeting, and it was like, okay, I have 8 ideas. Are you interested in either of these ideas? And because I had my private pilot's license, which I got at Michigan State, Top Gun was very interesting because I hadn't had any movie produced, but I figured if it didn't get made, at least I'd ride in a Navy jet. So I'd get something out of the project. I was serious, I mean, because I wanted a jet ride. Any pilot wants to get up in a Navy jet. They're really hard. So there was a long process where I wasn't sure. I didn't want to make the movie unless they were going to make it at 24,000 feet. We're going to get real jets. We went to the Pentagon. We talked to them. Yes, you can use anything you want. We'll give you anything. And so I wanted to make sure that it was going to be the movie that I saw, because I didn't want another unproduced movie. And I did a lot of research. That was, I think, the key to it, because although I'm a pilot, I don't go in the vertical. I don't go, you know, inverted. I don't pull G's like that. And so I interviewed about 30 pilots, Spent a lot of time at the base, NAS Miramar. I went up on several jet rides. The first one was fantastic. It was 45 minutes long. These guys, which pilots, Navy pilots love to do this. So we're up in the air and they go, "We're not supposed to be doing this, but," and then they do all these crazy things, you know, "We're not." And
was this an F5 or?
Yeah, it was an F5. And what was amazing about the experience, and I think this is why research is so critical, is that it was so exhausting. Hmm. It was pulling 8 Gs, you know, you're sweating and the physical nature of it. When I got off the plane, I was just drenched and exhausted. I called Jim and say, "No, this is not what I thought it is. This is a sports movie. These are the greatest athletes in the world. These guys, what they're able to do in a three-dimensional space and able to just, it's exhaustive." So that became our metaphor. So for me, Top Gun is a sports movie. It's really about the greatest sport in the world, which is aerial combat maneuvering. These are the greatest athletes. So and that was my metaphor because I was an athlete and Jim was an athlete, and we're able to. That was our way into it personally. So that was part of our involvement. So we then were involved with Simpson Bruckheimer, who were the producing team on it. And they gave us a lot of free rein, which I really appreciated.
And then Tom Cruise's involvement, I think, came pretty early on, or?
We wrote it with Tom in mind. I had been watching his career. I thought he was really interesting, All the Right Moves, Risky Business. And so we wrote it thinking Tom Cruise, because we wanted, you know, Maverick's a bit of a jerk. He's, you know, so you have to have somebody who's likable. And Tom is a very likable guy. And so we wrote it with Tom in mind. I gave it to Jerry Bruckheimer and said, "Think Tom Cruise." And so they read it, and Don Simpson called me after he read the script. And what you want every producer to say to you is, "I'll kill to get this movie made." Say, "Well, I hope you don't have to, but it's okay with me. You know, just go ahead."
Wow.
And so they just now had to convince Tom. Wow. The story's long. Paramount turned it down. They said, "No, we don't want to make this movie." Yeah, they said too many planes in the sky. Does that sound about right? One executive said, "No, it should be about how you fly this jet. It's really hard, and at the end, he figures out how to fly it." And we said, "No, we're not doing that."
Yeah.
There was a turnover of executives. A new executive came on. Frank Mancuso, he said to Don Simpson, "Don, what do you have? We don't have anything in the cupboard." "I've got this movie called Top Gun. I want to make it." I said, "Great, go make it."
Yeah, that's amazing.
So, I have to interject here and say, I discovered Tom Cruise. No, in all seriousness, for a TV pilot at Paramount, and he had done the one movie with Shelley Long, which was his first part, where Shelley Long gets divorced and goes to Tijuana, and he's a college student that meets him. He has a brave one scene, so I brought him in for a TV pilot at Paramount, and then the geniuses in television said, "He seems like a smart ass. America doesn't like a smart ass."
Right.
Brandon Tartikoff, who was at the time in his autobiography, he died very young. But anyway, he mentions this. But he says a producer. But I am the. He doesn't mention my name. But I just want credit for discovering Tom Cruise. You owe me.
wait. Has he sent you a check?
No, not yet.
He hasn't sent me one either. Come on, Tom. Tom, if you're listening, what camera are we on? Tom, send us a check. Come on. That's why you are where you are. Come on.
Well, Stephen, let's jump to 48 Hours, which is a 1982 movie starring Nick Nolte and Eddie Murphy, a breakout role for him. Directed by Walter Hill, IMDb logline for those who haven't seen it, a hard-nosed cop reluctantly teams up with a wisecracking criminal temporarily paroled to him in order to track down a killer. And if you've ever heard of a buddy cop movie, I mean, this is like the paradigmatic buddy cop movie. The movie grossed $78 million domestic, which today's numbers, $197 million, which would be, I think, given that budget, quite respectable.
$10 million budget, I think. I think it ended up creeping up to 13 maybe, but
wow.
It started out at 10, it went a little over.
So that's pretty good ROI. Yeah. And that's all domestic. They didn't have figures for international.
No.
I don't know. So what was your involvement in that movie and backstory of that?
Well, as I said, I had worked my way up the food chain at Universal Studios. I would make the one mention, it's usually the spec script gets you a job. It's very rare that you sell your spec script. What happened to me was when they read my spec scripts at Universal, they said, "We like this science fiction script you have, and we want you to make it into a two-part $6 million man for the season premiere of the third season." So I had the science fiction horror script, and the premise was that a space probe we had sent to explore the planet Venus went awry and came back to Earth. It was designed to capture life specimens, designed to survive on Venus, so it was indestructible because the Venusian. So anyway, said, first of all, it can't be an American space probe because we get all this help from NASA. So it's got to be a Russian space probe. And all those people that get sliced and diced, they're all out. They have to get almost. But anyway, I swallowed my pride, and that was my first. So I actually sold my first spec, and I worked my way up the food chain from story editor to producer. I had a moment where my contract was up, and in that moment, Paramount said, "Come, leave Universal, come here, and we'll get you in the movie business eventually." But the first thing that happened, they put me in the assembly line of television. So I wrote three pilots for Paramount that all sold. And the third one was called The Renegades, which is Patrick Swayze's first credit, and it's for Larry Gordon and Joel Silver. They produced the series. And it was written in front of the camera. It was basically, Aaron Spelling was the executive producer, and he could sell anything, the phone book, and they basically sold nothing. And now they had to have a script overnight. So at this time, people had noticed that I had a lot of humor in my scripts. It's kind of hard. You know, people are always worried, like, the humor will step on the suspense, or the suspense will undermine the humor. So I sort of established that I could do that in all these television shows. So after the success of The Renegades and the series sold, Larry and Joel said, "Listen, we have a picture about to go that's also an action movie, and it needs to have some comedy." And that was 48 Hours, which is a script that had been 15 years. Larry Gordon, like, develops very little, but he sticks with it. So the original script, if you know the movie, the burned out middle older cop was going to be Robert Mitchum, and the young Hood in prison was going to be Clint Eastwood. That's how long the script had been in development. And then for 5 minutes before I came in, they wanted to put Richard Pryor in the picture. Mm. And so someone had gone with Whiteout, even though Whiteout is, somebody had gone in and just changed the description of the character in prison, black. It was a different typeface. That was the extent of making it an African-American character. So basically, the picture had a release date. They had no cast, and they just threw me on it because, you know, I could work in this television pace. So the most amusing thing that happened is they had the actors come in to meet me. So Nick came in and he says, "Yeah, I'm gonna lose this gut. The studio's gonna get me a trainer." And he looked like, you know, that mugshot, that's what he looked like. So, and then Eddie came in. Remember, he had never done a movie. He was just, and so he came in, this is so cute, he wore a suit to meet me. He actually thought the writer was important. So after I met the two of them, I said, "You know, I want to write," and it's what I learned this in television, where you have people, and I mean, David Hasselhoff is not, you know, Anthony Hopkins, so you sort of write to fit the actor. And I said, "I want to go, don't cancel the gym for Nick. I'm going to write for Nick's character, and I'm going to, and let's have Eddie's character be like really slick and sharp." So that, these two people really informed the characters. Basically, I did my rewrite of this existing script in like 3 weeks. Now, I had a framework, but what I brought to it was, I would say to Walter sometimes when I was working, I said, "Isn't that cliche?" And he'd go, "There's no cliches in a Walter Hill picture. When I do them, they're archetypes." All right, so anyway, like, he had a lot of stuff we'd seen in other movies. Like, for example, the money everybody was chasing was in a safe deposit box. And I said, "You know, that's really old." He says, "No, it's..." But I convinced him to do the thing in the car, because that had happened to me in real life. I had a friend who was Australian and said, "Pick my car up. It's in long-term storage." And the actual place in the movie is where it happened. I'd never seen that kind of thing before, so that went in. And the original script, the cop couldn't go into this tough black bar, but Eddie could. And I said, "Well, that's not... What's that? What if it's like a redneck bar? You know, then it's like a whole different thing." So all these ideas I'm talking about, I presented after I read the script over the weekend. So for a while, there was a story that I rewrote the script in 48 hours, which is too perfect. But I did. But over the weekend, they gave me to read the existing script. I came in with these ideas to make it work, you know, for Nick and Eddie. And of course, the one thing we all said is, if you actually saw a bar in San Francisco where they were all dressed like that, it would be a gay bar. But like, the general audience, you know, wasn't aware of that. That was my first, you know, produced screen credit. But because, you know, the director was a writer on it, and the script had been around town for so long, I didn't really get sort of any attention off the script. So it's not like I was suffering. I'm still working in the studio. I'm doing television shows. But for about, I didn't get a single movie offer for almost 2 years. Mm-hmm. And then Commando came up. Mm-hmm. And then that sort of clinched it, because people could look at Commando and say, that reminds me of 48 Hours in, it's intense action, but there's a lot of comedy relief. Mm-hmm. And from that point on, I was doing a lot of these kind of movies, and it's sort of like, I still have television projects going, but it started moving more and more into that direction.
Oh, that's some really interesting insight into that movie. I'd like to jump to Dick Tracy, if we could. You actually were writing that before Top Gun.
Actually, before Top Gun.
1990 movie came out and did $162 million, and so today's dollars, that's $298 million. IMDb, summary of that: comic strip detective finds his life vastly complicated when breathless Mahoney makes advances toward him while he's trying to battle Big Boy Caprice's United Mob. And that starred Madonna and Warren Beatty, who also directed the movie. So maybe you could tell us a little bit about that experience.
Well, this one, what's unique about Dick Tracy is that there were four directors that I was involved in. So this is one of the few projects where the writer stays involved, but the directors keep getting fired. So that doesn't happen too often. It started with John Landis. It was his idea. John brought us on board based on our spec script that we had, no, actually an assignment that we had done called Whereabouts. And he was actually going to direct that movie. So he said, I want to do Dick Tracy, set it in the 30s, set it around Big Boy Caprice, go do it. You know, literally that was it, and go away and go do it. John had a bad accident. There was that Twilight Zone problem. John was removed from the project. Walter Hill was brought on board, and Joel Silver. And so did a draft for Walter Hill and Joel Silver. Then Warren Beatty was always considered the actor for the movie. Warren said to Walter, can I see dailies? And Walter said, I would never let my actor see dailies. Oh, there goes Walter Hill. He's gone. Then a move over to Paramount. Another director came on board, Dick Benjamin. And that didn't go anywhere. And then it died. And actually died for like 4 or 5 years. We went off to other projects. And as will happen to the movie, it gets resurrected. Warren actually got the rights to it, because the rights had lapsed, moved it over to Disney, and then made it in 1991, 1989, and did a little bit of work for Warren on that. Yeah. But it was interesting because it was trying finding, you know, that's an adaptation. What's the soul of this movie? What's the heart of it? And the first draft was, I did put Junior Tracy into it, and I did a very different draft because I loved all of the characters. And then when I gave it to Landis, he said, where is Junior in this movie? And I said, yeah, we need Junior in here. And that became a page one rewrite because the Tracy, Junior, and Tess was, it changed the movie so much because the core of it was now about a family, this family unit, mm-hmm. that we had to sort of like go back and reconceive the whole thing, mm-hmm. which in itself I never like to do if I can help that.
Yeah. I would come off of that and say what he just touched on is what happens more and more often, and probably all the time now on a blockbuster movie, is that it takes so long to develop that you can be there and different producers come and go. The studio management can change.
Yep.
The picture can actually get, I've had pictures that like were literally greenlit and they're ready to build sets and they get canceled and then it either dies or it comes back again later. So whereas on a smaller picture or a television show, the writer, if I make a metaphor, let's say you're making a voyage of an entertainment voyage, you're up in the ship, you're in the bridge of the ship, and there's the captain, and maybe you can pretend the writer's a navigator. I mean, on a blockbuster, you're like a passenger, like in the steerage section. That's why you see these blockbuster movies, there's multiple names, because writers, you know, you throw another writer on the barbecue. And also, when you're in development for a long time, you're subject to the vicissitudes of the marketplace and other pictures. So, like, I did a picture, I worked with John Landis on Beverly Hills Cop 3. Mm-hmm. So originally, it was going to be another one of my many pictures I did with Joel Silver. And Joel Silver managed to get Eddie and Landis to reconcile, but then Joel had a conflict with Eddie. So Joel was gone. So now the producer, and the original script was, they said, well, we already did the first to Beverly. I said, you know what's unique to Southern California? Let's do Disneyland. Let's tear Disneyland a new one. And everybody liked that. Eddie loved it. And the excuse was he was taking his niece to Disneyland. So I'm writing the script and it's dragging out, management's changing, and Eddie Murphy had a movie come out called The Distinguished Gentleman, where he was a con artist who was running for office. Gee, it was sort of like a documentary. But anyway, but in the picture, there's a little girl who gets leukemia from a cell phone tower, which already is like a urban myth. Anyway, the movie tanks, probably because it had all these bull children in the coming attractions. So they say to me, listen, kids don't work, take out the niece. Right, but it worked, right? So now why does he go to Disneyland, you know? You go on a little further. Then Eddie Murphy had another, then we had a romance that he was dating somebody who worked at Disneyland, right? But then we're in development so long, another movie comes out called Boomerang, which is a romantic comedy with Eddie Murphy, which tanked. And they said, Eddie Murphy doesn't work in a romantic comedy, take out that he's dating somebody. So instead of, so he ended up meeting the girl, her part was reduced. So, and finally, the 11th hour, Eddie, I guess, was bristling. He was looking at other actors, and he decided he needed to be a serious actor like Denzel Washington. And right before we shot it, the budget is slashed because the two movies had failed. So instead of building a theme park, we had to recycle a theme park. So they borrowed Universal Studios as an earthquake ride, and we called it Alien Invasion Ride because we had no money. This is a big Hollywood picture. And finally, 11th hour, Eddie says he doesn't want to be funny. And there's a memo I have, which I showed to somebody writing a book. A memo is, believe it, this is real. Eddie wants jokes taken out of the movie. He wants to be more serious. So this was like in a 2.5 year period. You know, it's like, who do you have to get off of this movie is one of those things. And the worst of all, they wanted me to do the other studio. Fox wanted me to do Die Hard 3, the third Die Hard picture, but I couldn't escape from Paramount. Oh, but anyway, like I said, other factors that have nothing to do with the story you're trying to tell, or even the creative desires of the key, I mean, the writer, director, they're all subject to the weather vane thinking of the studio reacting to what is going on in the real world, even politics, news events, and of course, the politics of Hollywood.
Yeah, well, you mentioned Die Hard 3. I do want to talk about Die Hard. Which came out and did $141 million in 1986. That's $287 million in today's dollars. For those of you who haven't seen it, I don't know.
I think it was 88. Yeah, 88.
That's right, sorry. John McClane, officer of the NYPD, tries to save his wife, Holly Gennaro, and several others that are taken hostage by German terrorist Hans Gruber during a Christmas party at Nakatomo Plaza in Los Angeles, starring Bruce Willis, Bonnie Bedelia, and Alan Rickman. That was his first role, directed by John McTiernan. That was an adaptation. You did an adaptation of a comic strip this was an adaptation of a novel. So maybe you could talk a bit about Die Hard.
Sure. The actual book is called Nothing Lasts Forever, which was a sequel to a book called The Detective by the same author. And a good trivia question is, if you go into a bar, you want to make a quick bar bet, you say, you know that character that Bruce Willis played in Die Hard 2 and Die Hard with a Vengeance, who was the first actor to play that part? And when they say Bruce Willis, you say, Frank Sinatra, grab your money before they beat you up, because Frank Sinatra made a movie called The Detective where he played exactly the same character, and the Bonnie Bedelia character was his wife who was in the hospital, she was sick. And because he had produced the movie with his own company, Fox had to go to him and say, we're making a sequel to that book that we made with you. Now, fortunately, Sinatra said, I'm too old and too rich to do this, otherwise the Chases in the building would have been on Rascal Scooters. So once he said, I'm out, they said, change the name from John Leyland to John McClane to sever like the ties to Sinatra's company. Otherwise, he would have still said, I have to be producer on the movie, so forth and so on. There had been a movie like I think in the 70s called Nothing Lasts Forever. It was kind of a chick flick. So Larry Gordon said, we can't use that title. And Shane Black had just written a spec script, which he's shown to Joel Silver, called Die Hard. And as Joel once said, I need that title. We'll come up with a better title for you later. So Die Hard, and that became Last Boy Scout. Anyway, there had already been a script written by Jeb Stuart. It was a very good writer who'd worked on The Fugitive and stuff like that. As he tells the story, Joel came in and said, listen, we got to make this movie in front of the camera. We've worked with Steven before. He was done, but he had an optional draft. And he can work at this pace. And, you know, it happens to all of us. You get replaced. So he wrote a really good script and made a couple of really very important changes. Like, for example, in the book, because it's a sequel, he's a retired cop. So he's like 62, not 32, right? And he's visiting his daughter, not his wife. And the other thing, at the time the book was written, CB radio was a craze. So that one person he's able to communicate with the building outside was a gypsy cab driver who had a CB radio. So he made him a cop. So these are really important pillars of the movie. What I brought to it was sort of changing the problem with the script. It was this terrorism thing, which was already kind of old then. So. I made them pretending to be terrorists, and I invented this cockamamie. When the book, you're totally in his head. The book is a third-person point of view, so you can have a 300-page novel where you have the guy remembering when his daughter was in danger, now was a little girl, remembering early cases he had, the last one time he was shot before he can work his way through the pain, and none of that. You're not in the head, so. I invented without that, it's like a stage wait. Why don't they just break the safe open? So I invented this cockamamie thing where these multiple locks, and then the preposterous idea that the villain doesn't tell his crew what it's up to, but that worked on the audience, is that you sort of secretly want the villains to succeed at every step of the way so you can figure out what the hell is going on. And two of the things that I think are worth mentioning about the spontaneity of working with a creative team where they trust you, a lot of directors don't like writers on the set, Because you may say something to an actor like, I think in your childhood you were scared of animals, and suddenly the actor, what is he doing? Why is he running away from the police dog? Did he talk to the writer? But, you know, I know the etiquette. So two things that happened. One was John McTiernan came to me and said, our star is ready to drop, because he's still filming Moonlighting in the daytime. He said, can you start finding things, fill out the supporting cast, do more with the supporting cast so Bruce can have some days off? So I started expanding the scenes with Alan Rickman, who was so wonderful. This is why we're shooting the movie. I expanded his scenes, added scenes where he confronts the wife, and she, you know, and her part grew because she confronts him. I built up the newspaper reporter, and it was just a small part, into a huge thing. And all that was actually to give Bruce a break. And most of all, and most famous, the scene where he meets Alan Rickman was not in the script, and we were sort of dying, how can we get them to meet? Because Joel Silver used to always say, Steve, the movies we make, they're hate movies. You know, a love story, you have cute meat, you date, you fight, you get married. These are hate movies. You have a cute meat, you hate each other, you come together, finally you kill them. So the problem was we couldn't get them to meet, and one day, when we had a break in the afternoon, they're coming around with snacks on the craft service wagon. Someone said to Alan, a lot of British actors do an American accent. Do you do an American accent? And he said, well, I don't know if I'd probably do an American accent, but I do like, you know, a California one. So everyone laughed, and I said, that's it. And I grabbed the director, and listen to this. And this morphed into, if he's only heard him on a walkie-talkie, he can meet him. He says, yes, but he saw him kill Takagi. And I said, did you shoot that yet? And he said, we're shooting it tomorrow. And I said, well, rethink that. And he said, all right, if by the end of the day you can bring me a scene I like, I will change it tomorrow so that somehow I'll figure it out that he doesn't see the person pulling the trigger on Takagi. Hmm. So they evicted the person in the nearest office of the soundstage, and I wrote the scene, which is only 3 pages, and that's how it came in the movie. And so this kind of thing, you know, I think happens when you have the synergy of not being like, you know, in Siberia, like too many writers are.
We're running a little short of time, but I know we started late, so I'm going to extend this a little bit, make an arbitrary decision to extend this by a few minutes. But if you do have some questions for Jack and Steven, you can get over to the microphone over there. We'll be opening that up in just a few minutes. There were a couple of questions from social media. Jack, a question from Judy Pataki about Top Gun. She said, quote, I read somewhere and don't know if it's true, that the love story was developed after preliminary screening revealed viewers wanted it. Is that any truth to that?
No, it's not true. No, there was always a love story. It was always the core of his love story. After screening, it was felt it wasn't strong enough, and so they went back and did some reshoots.
Okay.
For instance, the scene in the elevator is a reshoot, where she's wearing the ball cap and she's lost 15 pounds from the scene before, and then she gained it in the scene after. That was a reshoot.
But Charlie was always a female.
Absolutely.
Okay.
That was the core of the movie from the very center, because it was just part of it. It was. What's his emotional side? What is the other part of his journey?
And Steven, a question via Twitter from Raven Nevermore. the Yippee-ki-yay, right? Were there any discarded early versions of that phrase, or how did that phrase evolve?
Well, the way it happened is when I met Bruce, just when he came on the movie, and you know the famous story, they offered it to everybody in Hollywood, they all turned it down, because in that time in the 80s, you had these muscular stars, like Stallone gets tortured by commies, they, you know, electric cattle prods and whipping, and he breaks free and says, I'm coming to get you myself. So this is the other end of the universe. So every actor in Hollywood turned this down because on paper, the hero seemed passive, but the movie worked because he's a regular human being. So when I met Bruce for the first time and he had just come on the movie, we started talking and realized we grew up about 30 miles apart. We used to play Army Under the Boardwalk in Atlantic City. And we talked about shows he watched as a kid. And one of them was Roy Rogers had a TV show, and he ended the show saying, Yippee-ki-yay, kids. So that's how that came in there. So I think I wrote Yippee-ki-yay, asshole, and Bruce changed it to mother. On the set.
Okay. All right. Now let's talk about blockbusters, because they have been a staple of the business for a long time. Of course, Jaws came along and reinvented that. What's your take on where things are nowadays? Because the remakes, the sequels, the prequels, the pre-branded content, the obsession with franchises and whatnot. Where would a writer nowadays with aspirations to write a blockbuster movie, is that even just something that's out of the question? Or what are your thoughts on that generally?
I'll jump in first.
Sure.
Okay. No, if somebody wants to write it, they should absolutely jump in and write it. But what's going to get get them seen is their ability to write great characters, an amazing script that has tremendous action, great set pieces. So you say, oh, this is an action writer. This is really interesting. They know they have a visual sense of themselves as a writer. You have to be able to see the movie as you read it. You got to feel it. And understand you want that genre. I mean, what's happened today, one of the biggest changes is that 65% of box office is foreign and 35% is domestic, which means that changes the nature of blockbusters and what they are, the content-wise, which means that they're being made to play to a very big foreign box office, which means less dialogue, more visual effects, more big action. The school of thought is that the people in China don't want to read subtitles, so let's not have a bunch of dialogue. And so I think it's changed the nature of it, and then there's branded entertainment. So I think you have your board of directors, they're interested in their return on the money, and they feel safest by doing another, it's X-Men 55 or whatever it is, and just do one of those. They know there's a built-in market for those. Mm-hmm. So it's hard to get an original blockbuster, original big action adventure movie made, mm-hmm. unless it's coming from some source material, mm-hmm. such as a book or a comic book or something else that they can hold in their hands and say, oh, this is real, this is a real thing.
But what I'm hearing, so a strong genre piece, strong concept, yep. great characters, yep. great set pieces, those
and,
are keys.
And a great read. From great page read. One is like, wow, visualization, this is amazing.
Yeah, that's a factor. Your first audience is a reader, and a lot of people forget that. I've gone so far as literally when writing a script, like let's imaginary cop script, they search this room, clear. Suddenly a closet door opens and I would play my margin, so you have to turn the page and an ironing board falls out.
Yeah.
If I was doing, to make you turn the page.
No, it's actually true. The page itself is important to how you read it.
I would say that if you're starting out as a writer, if you write a super expensive blockbuster movie, you're sabotaging yourself because a lot of people will read it and say, we can't afford this movie. Mm-hmm. But if you do want to do that kind of thing, the way to maybe fit his paradigm, which is right, and to get over the intellectual property and the brand name is maybe pick a story we all know mm-hmm. from a Bible or legends. There's no coincidence there's like three Robin Hoods coming up now because Robin Hood's public domain. So if you like that kind of thing, I would say pick something that is public domain that is a really well-known title and exercise your blockbuster muscle on that one, because when people see the title of something they know, Space Musketeers or whatever it is, they'll say, oh, wait a minute, this is people have heard of this, and that will overcome the problem of it being a very expensive script to read. But in general, you're better off writing stuff that more studios can make, that independent producers can make. You write a blockbuster movie, there's like five studios that can make that.
Okay. Great.
Well, but it's something that you want to be writing would be something like Whiplash, where it's like an intense movie. It really reads well. You say, this is a really good writer. Michael Arndt doing Little Miss Sunshine. Well, he moved up to writing bigger and bigger movies because the character work and just what a good storyteller he is. And I think that's so important.
Yeah, you make a good point there, Stephen. I mean, there's like six buyers that can do those 100 right. to 200 million, where if you write a lower budget thing, that opens you up to literally dozens and dozens of companies.
Well, any script will be your sample. I mean, Jack said earlier, generally speaking, your sample opens the door, and then you say, well, we loved your sample. Here's what we are thinking of making.
What everybody wants to read is a contained screenplay. It's contained. It's cheap. You can make it for the $1 million, $2-3 million movie.
The other end of the universe from a blockbuster.
It is, but it makes a ton of money. Right. So in terms of the cost and what's being put out, the return is huge, and it can create a franchise.
Don't Breathe, for example, that's a picture that was, a lot of people wanted to make that movie. Everybody read its contained thing. They shot the exteriors in Detroit with a tax shelter from the Michigan Film Board, and all the interiors were shot, I think, in Latvia, Romania, somewhere in Eastern Europe where they built the interiors and the crews were inexpensive. Yeah. That movie cost like $10 million, and it was in profit the first weekend.
All right. Well, that's great. Let's get some questions here from the audience. Yes, first person, please.
Hi, thanks for doing this. Real quick, since you worked on Die Hard, I have that box set and I've listened to the commentary and all that. And just for everybody to know, there's trivia that everybody should be fascinated with, that Die Hard 3, Vengeance, probably is the only film in existence that predicts Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton competing against each other. If you go back and watch that, they're both referenced in that movie, which is bizarre. I was just watching it the other night. My question is, I'm actually a writer-director, so talking about blockbusters, my question is, when you have these concepts, these ideas for franchise and all that, and you have a wealth of ideas, talk about how kind of bringing those down to a more clean screenplay and maybe trying to keep more of the ideas off, or, you know, I'm even flirting with the idea where you actually take a lot of those ideas and maybe do an ebook, a novel or something, just to capture them. So, you know, when you struggle as a writer where you have almost too much meat and you have to really pare it down.
Well, that's a problem. You know, I'm a brutal editor on myself, and one thing that I thought I'm a genius, I figured this out myself until years later I saw an interview with Francis Coppola where he said he does it. He doesn't read what he's writing until he's done. So if I'm writing a screenplay, I will not read one page of the screenplay I'm writing until I have at least 80 or 90 pages. And then when I read it, I go, hey, this scene is unnecessary. But the day I wrote it, I thought it was brilliant. So you get some distance, so it's a way of winnowing down. And I think you have to do the same thing with your ideas. So I don't know how you lay things out. I do 3x5 cards on bulletin boards, and I have several bulletin boards, so it's like an animation studio. And then at a certain point, you notice it's piling up, it's too much. You have to, you know the old saying, you have to kill your darlings. So when you say kill your darlings, they're usually talking about pithy prose, you know, but it could also mean some of your ideas. And you see this in professionals. I recently, when there's a conflict, when there's a lot of writers on a movie, the Writers Guild does an arbitration, so there's not like gunfights in the street. So I recently did the arbitration for this movie coming out, Power Rangers. So there were multiple scripts by multiple writers over the years, but because the TV show was on forever, the first couple of scripts are like all over the, you know, literally the universe. You know what I mean? And you could see the people making the movie wrestling with less until they, you know, boiled it down and got something makeable at the end. And that's the same kind of thing you may have envisioned. You know, like I don't think George Lucas really imagined the prequels when he wrote the first movie. You know, and you know, maybe he didn't help the franchise with the prequels. So you need there's a reason there's seven Magnificent Seven, not the Magnificent 15. You know, the audience can only keep track of so many people and so many plot threads. So you know, you have to just be a real tough critic on yourself. That's all I can tell you.
Jack, you have any thoughts on that? Or
no, I think Steve covered it.
Okay.
Well.
Yeah. Next question.
Hi, you said you have to write the movie based around the actor sometimes, like in Top Gun's case, Tom Cruise. What does it mean when you're writing a movie with, say, Stallone or Schwarzenegger, where they have such a like crazy and famous persona, you have to write that into a character?
Well, it depends. We for Top Gun, we just thought Tom. Tom helped us center the movie. We didn't have him. So we were just saying, okay, I want this. This is the actor. It helps me think of the character. I can hear a voice. I can hear Tom's voice. I hear the character's voice. It helps me as a writer focus. So I cast the movie. I like to do that. Some writers don't. I don't know if you do that or not.
I do that.
Yeah, I think it's. I know that actor. I can write for the actor. I've also written for Tom Hanks and Michael J. Fox and Robert Redford. So when you know you're working with these actors, you know what they do best, and so you want to write for them. Write what they're going to accomplish, because you don't want to write something they can't do as an actor.
I would say, though, William Goldman in one of his books said he writes for an actor's in mind, but sometimes the actor he has in mind is already dead. In other words, whatever helps you capture a voice. So, for example, I frequently, when I'm writing something I don't know what's going to be, I actually have Humphrey Bogart and Audrey Hepburn in mind when I write a male or a female character.
They are dead, yes.
Yes. No, but I'm just saying to get a distinctive voice, and I find that people like it. You know, and it works. And maybe someone you never imagined plays the part, but you created a character and you distinct voice. One thing I would say to any writer is you should be able to tell which character is speaking, even if you cover the name.
Absolutely.
And the biggest mistake most writers make is everybody sounds like the writer, and they should not. They should all, one person could sound like you, but they should all sound like different people. And if you do it right, you'll be able to tell reading the dialogue. You should be able to, the way I check my own scripts when I'm done is I'll just read the dialogue and make sure that like these people have unique voices.
Okay. I think we have one more question, is that right? Yeah.
Yes, this is kind of related to the last question. When you're writing an earlier draft and you don't have an actor in, that you know will be cast, how do you kind of discover the characters for yourself so you can get to know them?
Jack, you want to take that?
Well, you've got to figure out what the story is. So it's not, it's a, what's the story, what's going on inside this character? I believe very much you write from the inside out. I have to know, I personally have to know what the problem is, what the character's struggling with, so that I understand what their voice is and how they, you know, I like characters in denial who don't really understand, they want to face their problems. So if I understand that of a character, then I understand how they externalize it, how their behavior is. And I understand also their voice and their attitudes. So if I understand a character's problems and what they want, then I can separate them. And like Steven says, each character has to have a very distinct voice. You can't have a scene if everybody sounds the same, but you can have a good scene if you have an optimist and a pessimist in the scene. That creates conflict and tension. So it's important to commit your characters to stories and attitudes. And if each character has a specific attitude in the scene, they're going to have a specific voice.
Do you ever write a bio for a character for yourself?
A little bit. I want to know. I ask a lot of questions, like why do they do this and what. You know, I don't have any rubber ducky moments, like, you know. In other words, when they're a child, someone stole their rubber ducky.
Yeah.
You know. So, but what I do look for is, you know, what's the core thing? What is that thing inside?
I'll make notes about a character, about their background, their life, and stuff like that. But it might just be, you know, like half a page. But if you, in the studio system, sometimes they force you to write, like, you know, the whole biography for your character, almost too much sometimes. But, you know, that can help you. Either pick an actor you like and pretend that's who's in the movie, or invent or write a biography for your character.
I think I'd like to ask one last question of you. Jack, you've written this book, Screenwriting is Rewriting, The Art and Craft of Professional Revision. Of course, we've all heard writing is rewriting.
Yeah.
So could you maybe talk to us, and Stephen too as well, like how do you approach rewriting? What are some of the keys of rewriting a script?
Well, rewriting is really hard. No one wants to rewrite. No one says, oh boy, I'm going to go rewrite my script, because you've written something and you either love it or you hate it. So it's really that sort of situation. And the hardest thing, I think, on rewriting, especially when you're, you know, if you're not in an environment where you're getting notes, is to know what to rewrite, what to fix. And what's really important is to get really quality notes, which can be really hard in Hollywood, because you get notes and you don't, they're crazy sometimes. So you have to read the note behind the note. So I think the key for people is to first find out what they have, because you write a script and you think you have something, but until somebody reads it and reacts to you, you don't really know what you have. So for me, gathering notes is a huge part of the process. I think organizing is important. How do you organize your rewrite? You just, you know, I'm not a believer where you just write a different draft of what you've written. But more, what I think you should do is figure out what the problems are and then address it in a really sort of systematic approach, rather than just sort of throwing the baby out with the bathwater, I'm going to write a different movie. Mm-hmm. There's always gold somewhere, something you did well in that script. And if you can discover what's working first and preserve what's working and then build out from what's working, and then figure out how, what do I change here and how do I add depth to it?
Okay. And Stephen, do you have any thoughts?
I would say very much the same thoughts you have. If you're wrestling with plot or construction, you're just going to have to wrestle with that in the middle of the night and try and figure out what went wrong, or maybe the first robbery should be earlier, or maybe we're beginning too early. Half the problems are you come into the script too soon. It applies to the scripts and scenes. Most scenes, people have trouble getting in. Like when I do seminars, I'll say, I want you to write a scene where two characters have a meal and one discovers something about the other one. So invariably people begin their scene, welcome, come in, would you table for two? Have a seat. Here's our menu. And it's like five pages before they even talk. And they say, you know, you don't have to show them, come in the restaurant. It doesn't even have to be a restaurant. You know, they could be two soldiers in the field with rations. But if I give you a tip for rewriting that I think works, and it's anybody can do it, is when I do a rewrite, I start in the middle. I open up the script in the middle, and I start working on that scene. So you're discarding, because if you start reading from the front, you know, it's great, you wrote it, you know, and you get trapped in the original thinking. So if you open up, if I have a 110-page script, I'll literally open up on page 55, and I'll start rewriting on page 55 until I don't have any more ideas. And then I split it again. I go from 55, I go to 24. And I jump around the script, I cut it in half, and I go back the other way, so I drop in halfway, and then a quarter, and then three quarters, and I carve it down and carve it down. And I find that I'm a much tougher editor on myself, because I'm sort of dropping in from the sky and just looking at a moment, not trying to keep the whole movie in my head. And I would recommend that to you if you're having difficulty rewriting.
Oh, that's interesting. I guess we got one last audience question, is that right? Yes.
Awesome. Hey, how are you? Thank you for coming. So I'm actually a big Street Fighter fan. And I just wanted to ask, I don't know if you were asked to direct again, if you even wanted to. The reason I bring it up is because, I mean, I have this tension in my own life of, am I a writer, am I a producer, am I a director? Do you think it takes a certain personality? Would you have done it again?
Well, on that picture, the biggest problem I had, I said earlier, there's a reason there's the Magnificent Seven, Seven Dwarfs, Seven Deadly Sins. When I got that assignment, they said, like, you've got too many characters, I want to have seven. But then as we got deeper into the movie, the video game companies kept putting more and more people and more and more people into the movie. And then they wanted to cast Van Damme, which made it an R-rated movie, except they wanted a PG-13 movie. So it came to be conflicting ideas. I've actually directed since then. I directed a movie nobody saw, but that was well-received, called Possessed, with Timothy Dalton and Christopher Plummer, which is the true story of The Exorcist. I have offers to direct right now. The problem with that is, if I go direct a movie, you're basically involved for, like, you know, 8 months to, like, a year and a half, and I don't get paid to direct what I get paid to write. So it's, like, actually sort of a decision of what you're doing with your life. If you work on a movie as a writer, unless you're trapped in a movie like Beverly Hills Cop 3, you know, you're basically done maybe in 4 or 5 months. So that's part of the factor. But I think the experience of wearing other hats is really valuable and informs your work as a writer. I know that if you're a competent writer in television, you quickly get promoted into becoming a producer. So I got to be a producer and started casting and editing and doing all those other processes because I started out as a writer. And in television, you got to fix, you know, you got to do 22 shows. So you have to fix all of them. And then you get frustrated seeing a director, like, you know, drop the ball, and you say, well, I'm going to direct something now. So I think you can move around. I don't think you have to just put yourself in a box. And a lot of people, you know, have multiple credits in multiple fields.
Okay. We've heard the phrase, the elevator pitch, right? So I'd like to get the elevator pitch from both of you about what's the one single best piece of advice you could give to these aspiring writers and filmmakers out here. Jack, do you got something?
Well, you know, it's sort of a cliche, but you've got to have a passion for what you do, and you have to have faith in yourself and believe in yourself as a writer or a director, whatever you're doing. So my elevator pitch is, if you really want it, you've got to drive yourself and totally commit yourself to the journey.
Yeah. Okay. How about you, Steve?
Well, that is absolutely true. Another thing I would say, if you're talking about working in, you know, so assuming you have the passion and you're going to do it anyway, if I were starting out today, I would not sit down and write 2 spec scripts. I'd be making short films and yes. putting them on social media, and people are getting discovered that way. It's just incredible. Once you get into the system, assuming you get your foot in the door of the studio system, you got to remember there is a lot of politics. You go into a meeting, right? There could be like 6 people in your meeting. And you don't know that 2 of them are fighting for a promotion and are trying to dazzle the boss in the room with their suggestions for your movie. So you really need to learn to read the room, right? You just want to get out of that room with the assignment or some kind of clear direction. So you really need to pay attention to the politics of the room and who's saying what. I mean, because I've been in situations where we had a story where 2 guys who had been rivals on the football field, one for the Naval Academy, one for West Point, and now later in life, one had gone bad and they were against each other. So we're talking, and then someone says, couldn't one of these characters be a woman? Sigourney Weaver, you know, well, that's an interesting idea. We could do that, and there's women in the academies now. Then they wouldn't have been on the football team. I know there's women. He says, well, does it have to be football? And then he says, maybe they have tennis teams. They have golf at West Point, and this is really happening. And the whole thing's unraveling, and this is not better. It's just people trying to get the attention of the top executive in the room by showing how clever their ideas are. And you can have, like, the entire sweater unravel, and they say, all right, let's think about that. Steve, see if you can make tennis or golf work, and we'll get back later. But then the idea at the movie that the one guy that threw the great pass, he throws the hand grenade, so now was he used a tennis racket? These things come up, and the domino effect of these, like, little notes, you know, can be incredibly destructive. So you got to learn to read the room. So maybe playing poker is good practice. I don't know. Well, you could do the Donald Trump technique where you say, well, I'll look into that. You know, that might. We're looking at that. We're thinking about that. But we're going to take a hard look at that. I mean, you can just get out of the room. Maybe I could say.
Well, I would say never agree to anything in the room. That's exactly.
Yes.
Don't say. You know what? Let me give that. Let me think about that. Run it around. I see what you're thinking about, and then go home and try to go, okay, maybe they'll forget the whole damn thing.
and they often do. Another thing you do is get somebody in the room to get invested in your thing. And I literally will pretend to be stuck. I'll go, so anyway, the FBI agent, he finds out where the terrorists are hiding from, as an informant? Yes, an informant. Yes, let me write that down, And now that person, I contributed to the movie there, now you're a champion, Yeah. Do that. Let people in the room save you.
Okay, well, that was great. What a tremendous conversation. You've been privy to some fantastic insight into the creative process in Hollywood. Let's give a hand here for Jack Epps and Stephen D'Souza.
Thank you.